Holy Chapel service will start in.
Let your glory fill this place. Church, say amen. Amen. God's been good to you, hasn't he? You notice he give you a new day, and it's a brand new day every day. I never had to use one yet. God's very good to us. Let us look to our responsive reading for the morning, Psalms number 122. I hope you brought your Bibles. When you found that place, please say amen. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together. For there are set thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David. Peace be within thy walls and prosperity within thy palaces. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. May the Lord bless the reading and hearing of his holy word. You may be seated. We will now receive our radio and bus ministry offering.
Time for Jesus, we are not ashamed.
We are not ashamed.
We are not ashamed.
We are not ashamed of the gospel,
oh Lord,
of Jesus Christ.
Whoa. Everybody sing it.
We are not ashamed.
We are not ashamed.
We are not ashamed of the gospel, whoa, of Jesus Christ.
Everlasting. All right. Somebody in the house that realizes how good the Lord has been, why don't you say thank you? Somebody that knows he's been better than that, you ought to say thank you. Somebody received a hallelujah praise along the way. You ought to lift those holy hands and shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor, look at your neighbor right now and say, neighbor, I love you. There's not a thing in the world you can do about it. Turn and share the same sentiment with another by saying, neighbor, I love you, and there's not a thing you can do about it. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, well now,
pray for me.
No,
pray for me.
Whoa, oh, 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 oh.
my brother.
Pray for me.
Pray for me. Oh, well now.
When you bow down.
When you bow down.
Oh.
Oh. Don't you forget.
Pray
for me.
Pray for me. Pray for me. The storm, 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 the storm storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah.
at the church say amen. Amen. Say amen again. Amen. Somebody give him a hand praise. Amen. Is God good? Has he been good to you? Well, we ought to give him some praise. Let's praise him like he's been good. Amen. Amen. First, giving honor and praise to our Almighty God and thankfulness for allowing us this opportunity to stand before you one more time. Amen. One more time. Somebody said it may be my last time. I don't know. Also like to give honor to our pastor for allowing us this opportunity to stand before you today. Amen. God is good. And he is worthy of all of our praise and honor. Amen. Amen. I'd like to also recognize my lovely wife. I thought she was in here. I don't see her. Oh, there she is. Amen. Amen. There she is. God bless her. She's here with us today, and we thank God for her. Amen. She's a wonderful wife, if I may say so myself. Amen. Amen. To deal with me is... it's not easy. Sometimes I get mad at myself, you know, or can't figure out why I'm doing what I'm doing. I don't know if you ever been down that road, but it happens. It happens. God is good. I don't want to hold you long today, and I won't, but I do want to get a message over to you. And the best way I know that you're getting the is when you say amen. Somebody know what I'm talking about.
Amen.
Amen. When I hear the amen, then I feel you understanding what we're talking about. And we want this word from God to be understood. We want you to go home a little better than you were before you came. Amen. Call your attention to the 143rd division of Psalms. Amen. And when you have that, please give us the usual sign of saying amen. I'm going to read the entire psalm here. 143. This is a psalm by David. It's a prayer. Oh, hear my prayer, O Lord. Give me ear to supplications in thine faithfulness. Answer me, and in thy righteousness. And enter into the judgment of thy servant. For in thy sight shall no man living be justified. For the enemy has pursued my soul and hath smitten my life down to the ground. He has made me to dwell in darkness as those that have been dead, that have long been dead. Therefore is my soul overwhelmed within me. My heart within me is desolate. I remember the days of old. I meditated on thy works. I mused on the work of thine hands. I stretched forth my hands unto thee. My soul thirsts after thee, as the thirst land salon. Hear me speedily, O Lord. my spirit faileth. Hide not thy face from me, lest I shall be like unto them that go down into the pit. Cause me to hear thine loving kindness in the morning, for in thee do I trust. Cause me to know the way within I should walk, for I lift up my soul unto thee. Deliver me, O Lord, from mine enemies. I flee unto thee to hide. Teach me to do thy will. For thou art my God. My spirit is good. Lead me into the land of unrighteousness. Quicken me. Quicken me, O Lord, for thy name's sake. For the righteousness' sake, bring my soul out of trouble. And of thy mercy, cut off my enemies and destroy all them that afflict my soul. For I am thy servant. We'd like to use for a subject, if we may today, our topic. Don't waste your time in the valley. Amen. You may be seated. Don't waste your time in the valley. Amen. We've had some rough days. The last, I would say, a year, but it is extended a couple of years. More than two. I don't believe I've ever seen it as bad, or things are in the situation that we are in today. I don't believe I've ever seen it. I've never remembered going to so many funerals in my life. We have just worked our dear pastor down to the bone. If he didn't wear boots, he had worn out shoes. He's been there. I wear shoes and I try to keep up a little bit, but it was a lot. And it may cause you to be a little downhearted. To be depressed, to be in a place where it just don't seem like there's no hope. But I came here to tell you that hope is still alive. Yes, sir. Amen. Yes, sir. Hope is alive, my brothers and sisters. Yes, sir. But the turmoil that's around us is there, and it's going to be there. We can't get around it. This happened back in David's time. That's what he's talking about here. He was in a rough place. But he persevered. God will give you the strength to persevere. But there's some things you need to do to have that confidence in yourself. That confidence in him. To know that he'll bring you through. Yeah. It takes something. There's some things you need to do. And a path you're going to have to walk before you get to a place where he needs us to be in these times. Yeah. One day a preacher who had just lost his family in a tragic fire had fallen into the depths of deep and dark depression, was walking down a city street. There he came upon a construction site. And this and the crew there was erecting a new church. He stopped and watched as they worked. And as he watched, he observed a worker who was busy carving a triangle out of stone with a chisel and a hammer. Stepping closer, he asked the stone cutter, "What was he carving?" The worker pointed up to the steeple on the top of the church and said, "Do you see that small opening up there near the steeple? See, well, I'm carving this stone down here so it will fit up there." Amen. Amen. I'm going to say that again, because see, I want you to get this. I'm carving down here, Doc, so it'll fit up there. Oh, yeah. See, it's this is not our homes, my brothers and sisters. We just passing through. Yeah, we have another home that's not made with hands. Yeah. Got many rooms. The preacher was so immediately stirred in his heart. He realized anew that faithfulness of God, and came to the understanding that the valley he was in at that moment was God's way of carving him down so he would be able to fit in up there. Yes, we live in a world that is filled with people just like that preacher. There are people around us who live their lives in depression and despair and defeat. There are some in that condition right now. Down through the years or through the ages, many of famous people have been plagued by difficulties of that sort, dealing with depression. Yes, great individuals such as George Washington, Martin Luther, John Adams, Winston Churchill, and many of our hymn writers dealt with this same ailment of depression. Yes. Even David, who is called a man after God's own heart, dealt with this same ailment. He suffered from depression and defeat. This psalm was born out of the time of depression, discouragement and defeat. So this morning we would like to spend a little time in these verses today. And by doing so, perhaps we can find help for those times when we have to walk through the valley. Perhaps we can find some help when we find ourselves in our time of overwhelming despair. We want to talk this morning in the passage, from this passage today, in an effort to encourage you. I know that there are many in the church today and in our community and are going through some very difficult valleys right now. I want to encourage you and challenge you, and I want you to sing, don't waste your valley. Don't waste it, because it's too valuable to your upbringing. It's too valuable for you as a Christian to discard your values. Understand what you went through. How you went through it. Who you ran into when you was there. Who came to your rescue while you were in it. Yes, yes, I know many of you do not want to believe, but God is in charge of our lives. The Bible says that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. And just as surely as God controls the direction of your life, he also controls the disruptions in your life. Yes, he controls the valleys. He determines the depth of the valley, the length of the valley, and their duration of the valley. Yes, he sends the valleys, seasons into our lives to develop us and to make us more like Jesus Christ, our Savior. So if God loves us, so, and he does, if God sends the valley our way, and he does, we would be foolish. You hear what I say? Somebody ought to say amen. We would be foolish to allow it to go past and not get anything out of it. Yes, yes. We consider the divisions of this song. Let us take time to reflect on what God is doing in us and moving through us in our valleys. Notice the characteristics of the valley that are revealed in this song. These characteristics teach us why we would be foolish to waste the time in the valley. God sends our way. In the valley, my brothers and sisters, is pain. That's what David was describing here in that third verse. He says it's darkness. And when you encounter darkness, you feel that you don't see nothing, you don't know nothing, you can't, it's just no help. It's no help. We don't see no help. Ain't no help coming. We in this all by ourselves. Yes, yes. These seem to be there seems to be no end to our pain and no light at the end of the tunnel. Many are in this very valley today. Pain of darkness. And then it's a pain of depression. In the fourth verse, David says that he was overwhelmed, surrounded, I guess you could say. When you say that you're overwhelmed, you give in this particular division of Psalms, he gives the idea that being encased in darkness is something that he feels that he's in right now. It is as if David could not behave what has happened. Believe what has happened to him. It is as if he had no heart to go down and solve the problem. Yes, the valleys in our lives are shared experiences. obviously there are many different types of valleys, and we don't all pass through the same places. There are valleys of sickness, death, turmoil, emotional distress, marital problems. There are valleys that touch the body, the soul and the mind, and the family. There are valleys in every description and kind. This one we are sharing in common is we all pass through valleys. That's one thing that we all going to share. And as long as you are alive, there is going to be some valleys in your life. Yes, John says in the 16th chapter and the 33rd verse, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. It's peace in Jesus. No matter what's going on around you, is peace in Jesus. He says, I'm a God of peace, not of confusion. Yeah, there's peace in Jesus. Yes, there is. In the world ye shall have tribulations, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Amen. See, he was down here. Amen. He walked and he talked down here. He know we can't bring a problem to him that he hadn't heard before. We can't do something that he hasn't seen before. We can't go to a place that he had never been before. So it's no fooling him. What he's saying is that I can help you. Yes. If you are one of many walking through the valley, there is hope for you today. You may feel that life has become unbearable. Let me encourage you today with all the despair that marks in this song. There's also much reason for rejoicing here. Yes. See, one thing about in the valley, there's some prizes to be won in the valley. You'll find out some stuff you didn't know nothing about. Or you'll be saying, I thought it was this when it was that. But you get down in the valley and you start going through those tribulations and those problems, you're going to have to figure it out. You ain't going to be thought no more. You're going to be saying, I know that I know. See, that's called wisdom. See, it's something about wisdom is that it's nothing you can learn in the school. It's what you done went through that I know. I say, I'm not going down that street because I've been down that street. And at the end of that street ain't something I want to see. There's prizes in the valley. Yeah. There's a prize of repentance. Our valleys, while they may always be result, is our valleys, while always are the result of living in a sin-cursed world, are not always caused by our sin. Yet, when we begin to seek God, our sins will always become an issue that makes us deal with it. Regardless of whether it was sin that was responsible for your valley, we are still sinners in a need of repentance. The valleys have a way of bringing us to our knees. Ain't that amazing? You can talk to a person till you blue in the face, and they won't hear nothing you got to say. It'll go in one ear and out the other. But let some hardship come upon them. The first thing they're going to say is, Lord, have mercy. And those that know the meaning of prayer, they're going down on their knees. They're going to start praying like they ain't never prayed before, Reverend. They're going to pray that God heal and take this misery and this tribulation away. Why? Why me? Oh, Lord. Why me? Yes. The valleys always have a way of taking us to the knees. The valleys have a way of causing us to reflect on our relationship with the Lord. Anything that brings us to a closer relationship with God is a prize. Amen. Somebody should say amen to that. Because the whole idea of everything is that somebody used to sing a song, and they still sometimes sing it, that what we want is a closer walk with thee. You understand what I'm saying? We need to have a closer walk with the Lord. That's what helps us in the valley. Yes, yes, amen. Let's move on. I'm almost finished. Don't go to sleep on me yet. All right. Anything that brings us closer to the relationship is a plus. Then there's a prize of remembrance. Yes, yeah, yeah. David, the stories, David had much to remember. The stories of what God had done for Israel and closer home, the great things God had done for him personally, the lion that he was able to slay. Y'all remember that, David, out there watching the sheep,
yes, sir.
The lion and the bear. And let us not forget about Big Goliath. Amen. He had something to remember. And see, that's what helps us. When we can remember, when we look back. Oh, boy. Oh. When I look back.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I think about where he has brought me from. Oh, now somebody know what I'm talking about. How he's keeping me still, even today. Oh, yes, it's something in remembrance. That's a prize to be able to remember. When walking through the valley, remember what God has done. Review your life and read his word. Remember how he saved your soul and changed your life. Remember how he has an abundantly blessed you. It is refreshed. He has refreshed your heart and encouraged you to carry on through the valleys. That was a man by the name of William Cowper. And William was a great hymn writer. He often lived in the depths of depression and despair. His desire, he hired a carriage one night to take him to London's bridge. He planned, his plan was to throw himself into the river and to end his life. However, when the driver picked him up and started for the bridge, they found themselves driving on hours and hours of a dense fog. Frustrated, Cowper's demanded that he get out and that he walk. And when he stepped out of the carriage, he was shocked to find that he was standing in front of his own door. It became apparent that the Lord still had use for his life. He entered his home and he penned the words of this famous song. God works in mysterious ways. Amen. When we are in the valley, we need a fresh. You hear what I say? I'm going to say that again. We need a fresh encounter with the Lord. We need to go to him in a way we ain't never went before.
Yes, sir.
We need to come with sincere hearts and the depths of what we are going through and how we know he's able to bring us through it.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Uh-oh. Yes, indeed. The prize of reliance. He says that here, he says that he was in that's the sixth verse, that it was a thirsty land, dry and parched, cracked ground that longed for refreshing water. David knew he couldn't produce what he needed. Therefore, he looked to God. Your valley has been designed especially to cause you to come to the end of yourself. Yes, when you get there, you will find that your valley has merely brought you to a place utterly dependent upon the Almighty God. See, when you depend on him, when you stand looking for him, knowing that he is your help, not some of your help, not a little bit of your help, but he's all of our help. Amen? Yeah, that you come to this point where you are dependent on him. That is not a bad place to be. As terrible as the valley of your life can be, there are also extremely valuable. It is in the valley that we learn the eternal truth about God that energizes and strengthens our faith. It was in the valley. It was in the furnace when the three Hebrew boys seen the value of knowing Almighty God. King Nebuchadnezzar said he was going to put them in the furnace. I don't know if they start praying. I don't know if they had a little shouting session. But one thing I do know is that they told the king that we know you're a great man. You do great things. You have built this great monument. And you want us all to build. They all bow down before it. But let me tell you something. I serve a God that is able to do above and exceedingly all that I could ever ask. I don't know God, King Nebuchadnezzar, if the fire that you're going to put us in is going to kill us. I don't know, King Nebuchadnezzar,
is that the heat of that seven times heat will that killed the folk when they opened the door to go in. I don't know, but I do know that if Jesus, my God, wants to save us, he's able. Don't you know he's able? He's able to take you out of your depression. He is able to make your mind feel so strong and determined that you won't let no depression keep you down. I serve a God today. That brings these things, these hardships, these tribulations upon us. And he do that to make us strong. If we didn't go through no problems, we wouldn't know what to thank God for, amen? So don't let these problems and tribulations that we go through on this earth be a surprise, first of all, because he's told us it's going to happen. And then let's not be surprised, because God has given us everything that we need to fight the enemy. That's why you see folk that know the Lord, when trials and tribulations come, they don't take them down. You say, how do you go through that? How do you do that? And you have the answer. You have the answer to tell them. That is by keeping our eyes on the Lord. By trusting in his holy word. By believing and knowing that he didn't bring us this far to leave us now. So whatever, as those Hebrews said, whatever happens, it's all right with my soul. Because my God is in control. And he's going to be there for me. He's been there for me. You know you can tell, I'm getting ready to sit down. But I need you to know this, that you can tell the difference in a young Christian and an older Christian. And I'm not talking about looking at the gray hair on their head. If you were talking to them and you couldn't see them. The ones that are mature have faith. They have trust. They believe. They don't worry about. Sometimes you may get a little upset, but you come to your senses when you pray, when you go to your knees. Yeah. And he'll let you know that I've never left and I never will. And whatever you in, I'm in there with you. You're not alone. He's there. He can hold you. He can keep you. He'll bring you out. Just trust and believe. God bless you. God keep you.
Repeat after me, please. God bless Reverend Causey. We've heard the word. We've all been in the valley. We might have to trek more times in the valley. But his word says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he's with you. His rod and his staff comfort us as we walk through the valley. The doors of the church are now open. There may be someone who's taken to heart the message that we just heard and is willing to give their life to Christ. If you're here and you don't have Jesus as your personal Savior, now is your golden opportunity.